One of the challenges in any continent is predicting precipitation from the perspective of agriculture and how do you secure your food supply. Historically, on the African continent, everyone has looked to El Niño to predict where the rain might happen in any given year. But El Niño is happening in the Pacific Ocean. And so we're trying to get a better understanding of how the Atlantic and the Indian Ocean play a role.
Stalagmites from caves are really amazing at reconstructing drought. This part of the African continent that's just south of the equator, there is a real gap for this kind of data. So I was looking for caves in the region and where they had reported that they had seen stalagmites. Angola on the west coast was one of them. The way to think about caves is that they're like this little home that protects things that are inside them. If you've had a tiger that got bones back to the cave, or if you've had floods that brought deposits into the cave in the past, the cave is really good at preserving all of them. So in that sense, yeah, caves are fantastic locations to look for paleontological records and archaeological records and climate records.
Right now, we're in Lubango, Angola, about an hour away from one of the more well-known caves in this region called Chivingero Cave, to study how evaporation and precipitation patterns have changed over the past tens of thousands of years.
Chivingero was one that really popped out from archaeological reports of Daniela De Matos, who's joined us on this trip.
The Chivingero Cave is located in southwestern Angola at about 1,600 meters above mean sea level. The Chivingero Cave is actually located on what we call a karstic depression, so where water gathers and then washes into the rock. Because of these conditions, there are wonderful stalactites and stalagmites.
And you do need a cave in order to grow a stalagmite.
The water falls onto the surface of the planet and it percolates through the rock and it absorbs different chemicals from the minerals as it moves through the rock. And then it drips into the cave where the atmospheric conditions change.
The amount of carbon dioxide in the water is much more than in the cave air. So in order to get balance, the water loses this carbon dioxide and you precipitate calcium carbonate again.
And as the water falls on the bedrock of the cave, it deposits a calcium carbonate mineral where the water lands. And that's what we refer to as stalagmites or stalactites. And that depends on whether it's hanging down from the ceiling or growing up from the ground.
And the way that I remember them was stalactites hold tight to the roof and stalagmites are on the floor and trying to reach the roof with all their might. Stalagmites record a lot about the environment around them all of the time that they've been precipitating. And stalagmites can really grow over tens of thousands of years. So it really gives us information from locally, did you have a drought at that time and what was the pattern of the drought, to much larger scale, like how were sea surface temperatures or circulation changes impacting these very local droughts.
For me, as an archaeologist, I'm interested in all the ways that the environment changed and how humans are involved in these changes. This partnership added a new dimension to the work that we've been doing here in the last few years.
No projeto das caves, eu tô com a doutora Daniela desde 2019 já. Eu estou interessada no processo de erosão dessa zona do Planalto. De que forma isso afeta, né, as grutas, a função das grutas. E o patrimônio geológico de Angola, especialmente.
Welcome to Chivingero Cave. Thank you, Daniela.
I'm always really excited to go into caves, because caves in particular, until you go inside, it's so hard to know what they would be like.
When we walk into the cave, you see there are water pools. So we actually have to pass wooden bridges to reach the interior of the cave.
Porém, no meio é um bocadinho difícil porque ele vai estreitando e também é úmido, o que dificulta muito a passagem.
It's just a little bit more of a crawl. You just need to lower your body a bit more.
That was not in your description.
Mas após isso, nós chegamos a salas maiores, não é, mais amplas. O que vamos encontrar, estalagmites, estalactites muito bonitas.
And these are some of the most beautiful karstic formations that we have here in Angola and that I've actually have seen in tropical karst.
Today was quite an adventure. It was very clear right off the bat that there were a lot of samples that were going to be useful for our research.
When we get a stalagmite, we want to know what happened, but we really also want to know when it happened. So usually when we first get the stalagmite, we cut it open and then we take a little bit of powder from the bottom, a little bit of powder from the top, and we send it off to a lab that can do radiometric dating. That will tell us the time period over which the stalagmite grew, and that's actually one of the most exciting parts, like when you get the result back and then you can see, oh, the stalagmite grew a few hundred years, or it grew a few thousand years, or it grew a couple thousand years and then really stopped for 10,000 years before it started again. It gives us a better way to formulate questions. The stalagmite is composed of calcium carbonate. The oxygen is from the water that was raining at that time. By studying the oxygen, we get some information about how the large water cycle changed in the past, because ultimately the water is coming from the ocean. The carbon is coming mainly from vegetation, so it also tells you about how the vegetation on the top of the cave might have changed in the past. Along with calcium, you can also get these tiny bits of other elements. So you can get some magnesium, you can get some strontium. That's what really tells us about the local drought. So how many years it went over, how severe it was, and that's what we really want, and then we link it up to all of the other things.
What we're really hoping is that the stalagmites that we collect come from a date range when the climate system was changing. By looking at how this region changed in those time periods, we can get a much better understanding of how this region might change in the next several hundred years when we are very likely to be undergoing a significant warming.
Our work is extremely important, not just for the academic community, but for all the community in Lubango and in the Huila province.
The goal very much is to understand how rainfall will change in Angola. You have climate models that are saying that when the temperature gets higher, this is how the rainfall is going to change, but there is no data to check against. So the nice thing is with stalagmites and with other natural archives like this, we can give them the data.